Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Pretty Pretty Boys by Gregory Ashe, narrated by Tristan James. Chapter 1. October 24th, Monday, 7 a.m. Emery Hazard woke up in his motel room at dawn. Mostly this was due to the light clawing in through the curtains. The curtains had probably been hung around the time of Hoover and had dissolved into a thin gray scrim. The Bridal Veil Motor Court, a dilapidated Art Deco motel, complete with glass block windows and a streamlined look that might have been modern 100 years ago, didn't offer coffee, but Hazard didn't need any. Awareness socked him in the jaw as soon as his eyes came open, the way it had every day for the last week. Every day since he'd been booted from his job and his home and sent, like a whipped dog, to the middle of nowhere, more specifically, to Wahredua, Missouri. And as he had every morning for the last week, Hazard lay wide-eyed and fought his way to clear thinking. This was not a nightmare. This was not a mistake. This was today, and it was going to be the rest of his life. He got to his feet because he'd realized things were better when he was up and moving. It kept him from thinking too much. The carpet, flat and greasy underfoot, helped too. Even in his nightmares, he'd never imagined carpet this awful. No, Hazard told himself as he padded to the window and twitched back the papery curtain. He didn't need coffee. The day-to-day stuff, the reality of being back in Wahredua, that had more jolt behind it than a box of no-dos. The air conditioner by his knees chugged and whirled out a half-hearted chill that smelled like the inside of a gym bag. Sunlight fell on his chest in hot, angry fingers. It was October, but it was still blazing and sticky in this part of the world. Between the slashes of sunlight, the glass mirrored the old scar carved just below his breastbone. Three short, shiny lines that might have been a C, or the beginnings of an E, or 6, or a G. Outside the window, with his view from the second story of the Bridal Veil Motor Court, Hazard saw Wahredua. It hadn't changed. That was the first new disappointment in a week. He'd arrived last night, tired and beaten, and he'd crawled into bed with the promise that maybe, somehow, this cramped Ozark town had turned into something else overnight. But it hadn't. Wahredua itself was a low sprawl of brick and concrete and the occasional glimmer of steel, built on a stretch of water known, a bit grandiosely, as the Grand River, and sprawled out like a 3-day drunk. The MP rail lines curved on the other side of town, an iron girdle for the sagging cityscape. Missouri Pacific hadn't run the lines in a century, but they were still called the MP lines, no matter how many times they changed hands. The sparkle of glass and a swath of green boulevard marked Wahredua's downtown, which consisted of approximately 3 miles of the state highway, where the speed limit dropped to 30. And there, pinned to the horizon against the backdrop of red leaves, the smokestacks of the Tegula plant still shot 3 white columns into the air, rigid, blocky clouds. They felt like the exclamation points at the end of a bad joke. At the end of this bad joke, Hazard thought. This bad joke of him back in Wahredua. Well, he thought, fuck me. He dressed for his new job, suit pants, shoulder holster, jacket. Being a detective for Wahredua PD meant, well, he wasn't sure. What kind of work was it? Finding stolen cows? Picking up runaway kids? Running off tramps? Helping Mrs. Gorse fend off her neighbor's chickens? St. Louis wasn't much of a city, but it had a certain grit, a kind of rugged insistence on itself, and more importantly, it had crime. The kind of crime that had drawn Hazard to law enforcement. Assault, rape, murder. His chance to make a broken world better, even if he could only do it after something worse had already happened. Jesus Christ, Hazard thought. In Wahredua, he'd spend 40 years on the force and be lucky if he did as much as give a speeding ticket. But, Hazard thought, as he pulled his black tie tight and checked himself in the mirror, he was going to do this job. He was going to do the hell out of it. He had come back here for a reason. Maybe to everyone else. To Billy, to their friends, to the cops that Hazard had left behind. It looked like Hazard was crawling back home because he didn't have any other options. But the truth was that Hazard could have gone somewhere else. 100 other places, if he'd put his mind to it. He hadn't, though. He'd come back to Wahredua because some sort of internal clock had ticked all the way around, and both of the hands were lined up at midnight. And Hazard knew it was time. It was time to go back home. Time to find answers to hard questions. Time to know the truth about what had happened to Jeff Langham. And once Hazard had those answers, once the clock started ticking again in a year or five, and once the shit settled down in St. Louis, he'd go back. Or if he didn't settle down, there were a lot of places he could go. Chicago, New York, L.A. Hell, they needed cops in San Francisco, right? And Billy loved San Francisco. But first, Emery Hazard was going to find the truth about that night when Jeff Langham had put a pistol in his mouth. As though on cue, Hazard's cell phone rang, interrupting his thoughts, and Billy's name flashed on the screen. "You're up early," Hazard said.
"I can't sleep without you. The bed's cold."
"Bullshit. You've been up all night. You never went to bed after the show." Billy laughed.
"Maybe, but the bed is cold."
"How'd it go?"
"It was a smash."
"Of course it was."
"Hey, Tom's getting everyone together for breakfast, so I've got to run in a minute. I wanted to wish you good luck."
"Thanks."
"Have they tried burning you at the stake already?"
"No angry villagers yet."
"Geez," Billy said. "What's a faggot got to do to get himself killed?"
"Probably just show up for work."
"I was kidding. They're going to love you. You'll turn that cow town upside down. A big city detective with a string of awesome cases. You'll have them eating out of your hand."
"That's the stupidest fucking thing I've heard today."
"Well, it's still early. Em, they really are going to love you. Times are different. You're different."
"Yeah, you'd better go."
"Tom can wait. You sound upset. And you..."
"Tom will be drunk off his ass on mimosas if you don't hurry." Billy sighed. And the sound was so familiar, so irritating and, at the same time, oddly comforting. A small piece of the life Hazard had left behind, albeit one that made him want to grind his teeth.
"I'll be down in a couple weeks, as soon as the show closes. You'll be settled. You can show me all your favorite childhood places. Introduce your colleagues to your gay wad boyfriend. It's going to be great."
Billy's voice muffled as he spoke to someone nearby, and then it came back.
"Tom says hi."
Hazard grunted. He didn't have any favorite childhood places. His favorite place in Wahredua had always been the state highway out of town. He had a feeling that wasn't going to change any time soon. "Tell Tom I don't appreciate him taking my boyfriend out to breakfast." Billy just laughed.
"Text me and let me know how it goes. Even if it's a complete train wreck. Especially if it's a complete train wreck."
"I wasn't joking about Tom. Tell him to back off." With another of his dramatic sighs, Billy said,
"Bye, Em."
The call disconnected, and Hazard was left staring at the phone's blank screen. Tom fucking Gerard. He'd already started, and Hazard hadn't been gone for a week. "Ladies and gentlemen, some respect for the dead, please." Hazard gave his tie one last jerk to straighten it and left the motor court. He got coffee at the local Casey's. Wahredua, as far as Hazard remembered, didn't have a Starbucks. It had a bakery, and it had been a good one, but the bakery had belonged to Bab Grames, mother of Michael Grames, the biggest bully in Wahredua from 3rd to 12th grade, and, for all Hazard knew, into the present.
He didn't look forward to crossing paths with Grahams or with anyone else from that part of his life. The Casey's convenience store seemed like a safer bet. Except, of course, that it wasn't, because Michael Grahams was working the cash register. Hazard's instincts kept him moving. He'd survived this long by being able to shrug off surprise, by being able to walk and talk and act like everything was normal, even when someone had just dumped a bucket of shit onto the table. That's what this felt like, a steaming bucketful slopped right in front of Hazard. But he kept moving, past the register with its racks of juicy fruit and Orbit and Sour Patch Kids, past the plastic-sealed stands of Marlboro and Virginia Slims and Lucky Strikes, past the slushy machines, Coke, Cherry, and something called Hawaii Explosion, until he reached the coffee. God, he really needed coffee. He snagged 2 donuts from the case, and then he couldn't put it off any longer. He had to look at Mikey Grahams. It had been 15 years since Hazard had seen Grahams, and it looked like Grahams had spent those 15 years sliding down the gravelly slope of hard alcohol, hard drugs, and probably hard women. It had chewed his ass to pulp. Grahams's eyes were bloodshot and baggy. His face had that sallow puffiness Hazard associated with alcoholics, and his hands trembled as he rang up the coffee and donuts. It was still Mikey, though. Christ, his name tag even said Mikey. But it was his face that had shocked Hazard like he'd grabbed a live wire that ran back 15 years. Even under the unhealthy flush and the pocked, scarred skin, it was still the face of a man who got off on being nasty, and the nastier, the better. It took everything in Hazard not to reach up and brush the scar on his chest. 3 short, shiny lines that were the start of a G. G for Grahams. Mikey Grahams's cronies, back then it had been Hugo Perry and John Henry Somerset, had held Hazard's arms while Grahams carved those lines with a Swiss Army knife. Then Hugo Perry had gone all cottage cheese, his face white and lumpy, then he'd broke and run, and that had spoiled the game for Grahams and Somerset, and they'd left Hazard bleeding and shirtless at the edge of the clay pits. And that hadn't been all of it. That had only been the start. That summer, when they'd really got going, when they'd gone after Jeff. 379, Grahams said with a cursory glance at Hazard. Hazard threw a 5 on the counter, grabbed his coffee and the donuts, and started for the door. Hey, mister. Jeff Langham. Hazard felt like he was vibrating, buzzing from trying to trap something inside. He didn't look back. He was aware that he was gripping the coffee too tightly, aware that the lid was about to pop off and spray scalding coffee everywhere, aware that he'd already pinched one of the donuts in half. But all of that was happening secondhand. What was happening firsthand was that dull, cheap Swiss Army knife digging into his skin. What was happening firsthand was the unmistakable desire to go back into the Casey's and crack Mikey Grahams's head open. Just crack it open, bang, 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 on the edge of that laminate countertop until the skull split. It'd be like dropping a ripe cantaloupe. Easy. The lid slipped, and hot coffee sloshed over his hand. Swearing, Hazard set the cup and the donuts on top of his car, shaking out his hand and spraying drops of coffee across the crisp blue check shirt Billy had bought him before he left. Screw this, Hazard wanted to say. Screw it. He could be a security guard. Hell, he could go back to school, be a lawyer, a doctor, be whatever the hell he wanted. He could be anything, anywhere. And he wouldn't have to be trapped in the middle of nowhere. Stubbornness, though, made him cap the coffee and climb into the car. He ate the fragmented donut first. He was a detective. He was a goddamn good detective. And he wasn't going to throw it all away because things had gone sideways. He was going to stick it out. He was going to do his time. And when the shit had settled, he was going to get out there, get a real job. San Francisco. Billy loved the hell out of San Francisco, and he could get into real theater, not the two-bit stuff in St. Louis. And, Hazard thought, savagely chewing the last of the second donut, while he was in Wahredua, he was going to make the most of his time. Hazard's hand drifted to the blue check shirt, tracing those short, sharp lines on his chest. While he was here, he was going to catch up with some old friends. It wasn't really any surprise that Grahams had drifted into a dead-end life of drugs and alcohol. What had happened to Hugo Perry and John Henry Somerset? Probably the same. Worse, Hazard hoped. Grahams had carved up Hazard's chest. John Henry Somerset had named him faggot in front of the whole school. Yeah, Hazard hoped a hell of a lot worse had happened to John Henry. The Wahredua PD occupied a building that had originally been a Catholic school. The structure had the grim severity associated with those kinds of schools in the public mind. Sharp lines of red brick with cramped windows and dark glass. When the city had taken over the building, it had removed as much of the religious iconography as it could. Carved angels and saints and gargoyles had been torn down. Hazard remembered he'd been maybe 12 when it happened, and he'd watched the workmen hammering and chiseling and smashing with no regard for the artisanry they were destroying. All of that had ended, though, when Mary Wilk, the only woman on the entire crew, had fallen from the scaffolding and broke her ankle. The city had decided that enough was enough, and the spurt of iconoclasm stopped early. The decorative stonework above the door still held a bedraggled angel, who had lost half of his face to a chisel and a devil. The angel was trying to spear the devil, but in the demolition, the spear had been broken, and now it just looked like the angel was pointing at the devil with a yardstick. The devil was having a hell of a laugh about the situation, and the whole thing seemed pretty damn fitting for Wahredua PD. Even God knew they were a joke. Hazard parked at the back of the lot, away from the row of shiny Chevy Impalas that looked freshly painted with the Wahredua PD design, and chugged the last of his coffee. It was going to be rough. No, it was going to be a bitch. But he had to go in there. The first day was going to be the worst, and then it would get better. It had to get better. When he entered the station, a blast of cool air met him. The building smelled like fresh linoleum, a rubbery kind of smell, and coffee, and an institutional, office-like smell that made Hazard think of freshly sharpened pencils. Graphite, that's what it was. He stood in a small waiting area where a duty officer sat behind a desk. "Can I help you?" The man had to have been almost 80, and he had nose hairs growing down to his chin. And he must have been on the force when Hazard was a boy, but Hazard didn't remember him. His badge looked like someone had dug it out of the Ark of the Covenant, probably from somewhere near the bottom, and it read, J. Murray. "Emery Hazard, I'm new, starting today." The old man's head bobbled, sending his nose hairs trembling, and then he jerked a thumb. "Straight back, Chief's office. She's waiting for you." Hazard nodded and made his way along the hallway. He passed the bullpen, where classrooms had been knocked down to create a large, open workspace. At least a dozen desks filled the space, and copiers and fax machines and filing cabinets had been jammed into any remaining available space. A handful of men and women in uniform worked quietly. The rest, Hazard guessed, were either off duty or out on patrol. The chief's office was clearly marked at the back of the bullpen, with Martha Craven's chief of police printed in block letters across the glass. The office, though, had once served another purpose. On the frame above the door, relatively lighter wood showed where painted letters had once stood, and Hazard could read what they had once said, Mother Superior. That probably wasn't far from the truth. After his knock, a voice called for him to enter. Hazard stepped into the spacious office. His eyes took in the large glass-topped desk, the modern computer equipment, the city map on the wall with red and blue pushpins, and the woman behind the desk. Martha Cravens had been a familiar figure in Hazard's boyhood, the only woman in Wahredua's police force. But it wasn't Martha Cravens who occupied Hazard's attention. For the second time that day, he grabbed onto the live wire from the past, but this time he was galvanized, unable to move or blink or breathe. Sitting in front of Cravens's desk, he was a blonde and well-built and very, very good-looking. The kind of good-looking that stops traffic for about a mile in every direction. His blue eyes crinkled with amusement, and he grinned as he rose, stretching out a hand. Hazard couldn't move, couldn't blink, couldn't breathe. He couldn't have grabbed that man's hand if the earth dropped out from under him. He could barely hear Cravens talking.
"Happy to have you, Mr. Hazard. And this is your new partner. You went to school together, I think. Do you remember?"
"John Henry," Hazard managed to say. John Henry Somerset, who had pushed him down the only flight of stairs in Wahredua High, and said, "That's what faggots get." John Henry's smile wavered, as though he had glimpsed something uncertain in Hazard's expression, but then it firmed up again. He lunged forward, seizing Hazard's hand and shaking it vigorously, like they were buddies in a 1950s sitcom, buddies catching up after a long time apart.
"Hey, Emery. Great to see you again, man."
Chapter 2. October 24th. Monday, 8:03 a.m. John Henry Somerset, who had gone by Summers since his first day at Mizzou, gave Emery Hazard's hand one last shake. Summers waited for something, a smile, a nod, a blink. Hazard looked like he'd swallowed a frog, or maybe a stick of dynamite. He was breathing funny, and his face had gone pale and shiny. Summers was starting to think that Hazard was having a stroke.
"You all right?" Summers said.
With a curious shake of his head that might have meant either no or yes, Hazard pulled back from Summers' grip and turned his attention to Cravens. Summers settled back into his chair to watch. You could learn a lot just by watching, and so he paid attention to Hazard as Cravens went through introductions. Hazard had changed. That was the understatement of the year, maybe of the decade. Gone was the scrawny boy with a mop of dark hair always falling into his eyes. That boy, the boy Summers had gone to high school with, the boy with the scarecrow build and scarecrow eyes, had disappeared into someone who was stacked. That was the only way to put it. Emery Hazard was a beast. The blue check shirt with coffee stains, had he been nervous or just in a hurry? Strained to cover his shoulders and revealed massive arms. His dark hair no longer fell into his eyes. It was long, especially for a police officer, but still in a conservative cut in part. The eyes, though, the eyes were still scarecrow eyes. The color of straw at the end of summer, almost the color of honey, but hard. Hard like he could crack the universe if it swung a little too close. And Hazard wasn't looking at Summers. It wasn't that his attention was fixed on Cravens. Summers wasn't even sure if Hazard could hear Cravens. Hazard wasn't looking at Summers, actively not looking at him. And Summers had the feeling that he could douse himself in gasoline and jump through a ring of fire, and Hazard would just keep staring at Cravens with that painfully fixed expression that showed just how hard he was trying not to look at Summers.
Jesus, Summers wanted to say. Was it really that bad?
Summers hadn't forgotten high school. He hadn't forgotten filling Hazard's locker with shaving cream. He hadn't forgotten TPing his house. He hadn't forgotten stealing Hazard's books and dumping them into the Grand. He hadn't forgotten, for goddamn sure, the day he'd held Hazard's arm while Hugo held the other, and Mikey Grames, the twisted fuck, sliced up Hazard's chest. Summers hadn't forgotten his encounter with Hazard backstage after Guys and Dolls, and he hadn't forgotten shoving Hazard down the steps and saying, "Just wanted to see if a faggot's neck could break like anybody else's." Summers knew his face was heating, It came with his fair skin. He hadn't forgotten any of it, not any of the shit he'd pulled. But when he'd learned that Emery Hazard was going to be his partner, Somers had hoped against hope, that Hazard might have forgotten a little. Judging by how rigidly Hazard stood, by his pallor, by the way he looked at Cravens like she was the only person in the room, Hazard hadn't forgotten anything either. It was going to be a long, hard climb out of that shit, Somers decided. But he was going to do it. Somehow, he could do it.
"That's all you need to hear from me," Cravens said.
She was good like that, didn't carry on, didn't get too puffed up with the job.
"Somers here has offered to show you around the station, and then you boys have work to do."
At Somers's name, Hazard's eyes flicked towards him. The gesture was involuntary, Somers could tell. Hazard snapped them back towards Cravens as fast as he could, but Somers had seen what he'd expected to see. Hate, fury, and loathing. "All right," Somers said to himself. It felt like the mental equivalent of rolling his shoulders like a boxer warming up. "All right, I deserve that."
"Who?"
Hazard said. Cravens, already sinking into the chair behind the glass desktop, glanced up as though surprised they were still here.
"Who is going to show me around?"
Hazard repeated. His voice had firmed up, brusque and neutral, but intense, like the gauges were swinging to red and the pressure was building.
"Somers,"
Craven repeated, obviously confused and pointing with her hand across the desk.
"I thought you two..."
"Yeah," Somers said, springing to his feet and giving a jerk of his head towards the door. "I went by John Henry back then. A real mouthful. Now it's just Somers. Come on." Hazard's gaze moved from Craven's to the middle ground, never quite reaching Somers' face. Then Hazard gave a nod, and Somers ushered him out of the office. The bullpen had emptied, thank God, except for two uniformed officers. "That's Miranda Carmichael," Somers said, nodding at one. "She issues about half the monthly speeding tickets, single-handedly, and every time you look, she'll be busy with a stack of paperwork." "That," he nodded at the other, who reclined behind a newspaper with his feet on the desk. "That's George O'Rear, who's in charge of the fleet, at least on paper. Gets here about 8 a.m, leaves at 5, and he only moves from that desk when he has to go to the can." Hazard's lip curled, but he said nothing. "So this is the bullpen, obviously. Those four desks in that corner, those are ours. The detectives, you, me, Swinney, Lender. Upchurch is using his vacation time, and I don't think he's cleared out his desk yet, but we'll get you sorted." Still nothing from Hazard. "Car's already got everything we'll need. Upchurch and I kept everything spick and span. You want to stop by requisitions and pick up anything?" Hazard shook his head. "I'll show you the place then, and we'll get going." Somers waited, and when no response came, turned and led the way deeper into the station. The silence was weighing on him, and he found himself speaking to break the silence.
"So, O'Rear, you know, that guy back there. O'Rear's an interesting case. In 2003, Chaz Elder accused him of assaulting him during a traffic stop. Never mind that Chaz Elder weighed 300 pounds and stood 12 inches taller than O'Rear. You know, Chaz?" More of that goddamn silence. It was like quicksand. Somers felt himself sinking in it.
"Anyway, they stripped O'Rear of his gun and badge and left to petrify in the fleet. Turns out, Chaz threw a punch. He's a big guy, right? And one time, swear to God, I saw him pound a pumpkin into jelly. Just a couple of hard hits. Anyway, O'Rear got cleared, but the worst part was, even after the whole mess shook out, O'Rear stayed right where he was. Said he had corns on his feet or some shit like that. I mean, my feet hurt at the end of the day, but I'd rather be out hitting pavement than buried alive, right?"
"You want to talk about my fucking feet?"
"What? God, no. I just meant, O'Rear, he's like an example.
how this stuff can wear you down. But Hazard had lapsed back into silence, and Summers knew his own face had to be cherry-colored by that point. He pointed out the can, the locker rooms, requisitions, evidence, and the jail at the back of the building. "Three suites," Summers said. The words just kept pouring out of him, and he knew he needed to stop, but he couldn't. "We've usually only got drunks in here. A couple of them like it better than home. Can't say I blame them sometimes. Guy just needs some peace and quiet, right?"
"You done?"
Yeah.
"What do you and Upchurch have?"
"Cases, you mean?"
Summers tried for a grin. "Oh, you know, big stuff. Mafia crime bosses, sleeper cell terrorists, general murder and mayhem."
"Hey, wait, where are you going?"
He caught at Hazard's sleeve as the other man turned. Hazard knocked Summers' hand away.
"What the hell did you tell Cravens?"
"What?"
"Nothing. She kept talking about us like we were..." He seemed to be searching for a word, and it wouldn't come.
"Buddies,"
Hazard finally managed. "I'm going to put the record straight. I'll work with Swinney or Lender, but I'm not..."
"Jesus, don't do that."
Summers scrambled to plant himself in Hazard's way, and for a moment he didn't think Hazard would stop.
"All right. I told her we were friends. Back in the day, I mean. I told her we lost touch and..."
"Why?"
"Look, I..."
"What the fuck do you want from me?"
"Nothing. I just..."
"Get out of my way. I'm done with this."
As Hazard barged past, Summers managed to say,
"It's the case."
Hazard froze and turned.
"What?"
"It's this case. Well, it's a lot of things. I feel really shitty about how I treated you in high school, and I wanted to make things right."
Hazard said nothing, only watching with those scarecrow eyes. "I know I was a dick, but I was a kid, and I was... Look, I was an absolute idiot, all right? And anyway, I read your application, and I know all about the kind of stuff you did in St. Louis. You're the real deal. I want to work with the real deal. Upchurch is fine, but he's... I don't know. You'll see. He's Upchurch."
Shaking his head in disgust, Hazard started to turn once more.
"Swinney and Lender only do drugs." Hazard froze, his back still turned to Summers, and after a moment, Summers continued. "Meth cases, mostly. Although there's other stuff. But it's boring. It's the same old thing over and over again. Upchurch and I, you and I. We get everything else. Homicide, kidnapping, rape, everything. And you're the real deal, like I said. And..."
"This case?"
"Yeah, it's..." "So the department's had some trouble lately. PR stuff, mostly. Nothing legitimate. But that kind of a bad rep can stick for a long time, and Cravens's job is on the line."
Slowly, Hazard turned. Those burnt straw eyes latched onto Summers, and again, Summers had the impression that this man was running at full steam, that the gauges were deep in the red, and one wrong word could make everything blow.
"What kind of PR trouble?"
"The LGBT community." A ripple of something. Summers couldn't say exactly what, but it looked murderous. Passed through Hazard's face and then was gone, leaving the same look of brutal intensity. A soft chuckle, at odds with that look, escaped from Hazard's mouth, but it wasn't a happy sound.
"So I'm a PR hire?"
"I wanted..."
"Shut up."
Hazard seemed to think for a minute, and then he said,
"What are we doing? With the case, I mean.
We've got an interview this morning."
"Let's go. I'm already sick of this shithole. And on the way, you're going to tell me every fucking word between you and Cravens. Right?"
Summers swallowed.
"Right." He had a feeling that climbing out of this was going to be a lot harder than he'd expected. Chapter 3. October 24th. Monday. 9:12 a.m. They drove in a tan Impala with cloth seats and a pine-scented air freshener glued to the central vent. Neither man spoke, and Hazard took advantage of the silence to reorient himself. He'd lost his cool as soon as Summers had opened his mouth. No, it was worse than that. He'd lost control. It was like he'd been outside his head, watching, unable to stop as he got angrier and angrier. Every word Summers had said had been like dumping gasoline on a house fire. And it didn't help that Summers was so breezy. Everything he did and said came off cool, collected, composed, like he didn't have a fuck to give for anything or anyone. In spite of his determination not to look, Hazard studied the man. John Henry Somerset hadn't changed. Sure, his blonde hair was shorter and crisply styled, and he'd added on a few inches of lean muscle, but the major things hadn't changed. He still had his preppy good looks, his smooth golden tan, his eyes like tide pools, jaw cut sharp as a straight razor. He still had that way of walking, his shoulders back and his head up, like he owned this city and the next one over, and he expected everyone to know it. Perfect, the word popped into Hazard's head. John Henry was still so goddamn perfect. Summers shifted, as though sensing Hazard's gaze, and adjusted his grip on the steering wheel. His cuffs slid back, exposing a stretch of darkly inked skin. Well, Hazard thought, that was very interesting. The golden boy had a tattoo. Maybe John Henry had changed a little. The guy we're going to see, he's a college student. His name is Resendo, I think. I've got it written down. He reported vandalism this morning, and a patrol car went past. They passed it up to us. Because it has to do with what? This PR crap? With a small shrug, Summers said, kind of. There's been a lot of this going around. Vandalism? That's what we deal with? This is about the most interesting thing we've had all year. And it's not just vandalism. It's a hate crime or the next thing to it. LGBT community is getting targeted for the most part, although it spills over. And I'm the Band-Aid? That's not what I meant. The fuck it isn't. What were they going to do? Hire me, parade me around town, show everybody they were a progressive department, and then what? Shove me in a corner to do paperwork? Summers didn't answer. After a moment, Hazard laughed. The LGBT community, huh? What? You guys finally have enough queers around here to throw a stick at? Guess things change. There's always been a community here. You know, because of the college. But you're right. Things have changed. The way Summers said it, with that earnest tone and Boy Scout look, made it clear what he meant. He meant that he'd changed. That Wahredua had changed. That the world had changed. That was a nice dish of bullcrap, as far as Hazard was concerned. Roxel, Hazard said. That's like two classrooms and a cafeteria. Maybe 20 years ago. They've grown a lot. Enrollment is around 15,000. 15,000? You're joking. No, and Wahredua has grown too. The city's pushing 90,000. We're officially a city, you know, not a town anymore. And the college has brought the blue vote. All the old hippies, organic farmers, musicians, deadheads. It's different. Hazard grunted. He'd believe it when he saw it. Tell me about Cravens. She's decent. She's a politician. But only because that's her job. She'll stick by you for the most part. She bakes some good cupcakes and brings them on Fridays. What'd you have to say to get her to hire me? She wanted to hire you. I didn't have to say anything. What'd you say? She thought you'd be good as the department's face. You know, brooding detective, great shoulders, killer ass. You could... Hazard felt that same old house fire burning deep inside him. What'd you say? It was just a joke. Come on, lighten up. Jesus, you really are the same, aren't you? All right, let's get it all out on the table. Yeah, I'm gay. I like to fuck guys. Is that clear? Summers was shaking his head, his eyes fixed on the road. I asked you a question. Yeah. All right.
You think it's funny or weird or gross? Fine. You want to give me shit about it? Fine. You want to make my life hell? Fine. I'm not the kid you used to push around. I've done this whole pony show before. If you think you've got something that the guys in St. Louis didn't already try, you've got another thing coming. It didn't work for them, and it sure as hell isn't going to work for you. I'm not going to... Jesus Christ, Summers growled, his cool snapping for the first time since Hazard had seen him. Summers jerked the wheel to the right, and the tires rumbled against the curb. They pulled to the end of the block, and Summers unbuckled his seatbelt. Get out of the car, right now. Without waiting for a reply, Summers kicked his door open and walked to the sidewalk. Hazard only hesitated a moment. He had his .38, and if it came to that, he wouldn't hesitate to put a bullet in John Henry's perfect golden tan. But the best odds were that Summers was going to try to slug him. Summers was right-handed. He had muscle, but lean, more like a runner. He didn't have Hazard's bulk. Hazard knew the drill. He'd move into the punch, take it on his shoulder or arm instead of on his jaw, and then he'd land one that would knock Summers out of the county. When Hazard got to the sidewalk, though, Summers just shrugged out of his jacket, folded it, and held it out to Hazard. Hazard stared at the coat and raised an eyebrow. Hold it for me, Summers insisted. And then why don't you break my jaw or nose or whatever the fuck you're determined to do, and then we can get on with our day. Hazard hesitated again. Was this a fake out? Would he swing as soon as Hazard reached for the jacket? For God's sake, Summers grumbled. He tossed the jacket on the ground and took a step forward, tilting his head back and presenting his jaw. I fucked up in high school. I get it. This is your chance. Yeah, and get myself out of a job on the first day? I'm not that stupid. You want to record me? You want this taped? I'll say whatever you want me to say. You've got my permission to take off my fucking head, so go on and do it. I fucked up, so let's make it right. The heat of the day, even this early, prickled on Hazard's neck. Sweat dampened his armpits and the small of his back. Somehow, again, Summers had thrown him off balance, and Hazard couldn't seem to get his feet planted. Summers took another step forward. They were close enough now that Hazard could feel the heat pouring off Summers, could smell the clean scent of Summers's deodorant, could see the nearly invisible blonde stubble on Summers's jaw. Are you going to do it or not? Either you hit me right now as hard as you want, as much as you want, and you get it out of your fucking system, or you drop the chip from your shoulder and we go do this interview. I don't know about you, but I want to do my job. Fuck you. Summers waited a full minute, his eyes still locked with Hazard's, before Hazard finally looked away. Summers grunted and got back into the Impala. After a moment, Hazard followed. Then he stopped, turned back, and gathered the fallen jacket. He dusted it off and climbed into the passenger seat. Wordlessly, he shoved the jacket at Summers. Thanks. Let's get one thing straight, Hazard said, his eyes on the dashboard. I'll work with you. I'm your partner. I've got your back, as far as that goes, and you can count on me when it comes to the job. But if you think I'm going to forgive and forget because you've gone to college and you think you're open-minded now and can crack jokes with your faggot partner, you're wrong. I know you. I know the special kind of piece of shit you are, even if nobody else knows. Even if you've got them all fooled. I know. Hazard tapped his chest where the three shiny lines still marked him, but inside, he was thinking about what Mikey Grames and Hugo Perry and John Henry Somerset had done to Jeff. That summer when they'd cut up Hazard's chest, what they'd done to Jeff when they'd really gotten going. You made sure I'd never forget. Summers paled as he took the jacket. He held it awkwardly, as though unsure of what to do with it, and then dropped it in his lap. He fumbled the key in the ignition, started the car, and then, his face pitched towards the floorboards, said, I know I fucked up, but I am different. All I'm saying is give me a chance.
Hazard didn't answer. He'd said everything he needed to say. Struggle showed in Summers's face, and as he shifted the car into gear, he blurted, "And I wasn't cracking jokes or trying to be funny. You do have a killer ass, so fuck you."
And that, Hazard decided as they pulled away from the curb, made it official. The whole world had gone batshit.
Chapter 4. October 24th. Monday. 9:45 a.m.
It could have gone worse, Somers told himself for the 100th time as they drove. It could have gone so much worse. The problem was, though, that he wasn't sure exactly how it could have gone worse. It would have been a relief, in some ways, if Hazard had hit him. It would have made up for it. Gotten some of the hostility out in the open. But Hazard hadn't hit him. Once again, Hazard had defied Summers' expectations, and that just made Summers feel worse.
"And why the hell," Summers asked himself, "did you tell him he had a killer ass?"
Now Hazard brooded, staring out the window as they drove and refusing to respond to any of Summers' attempts at conversation. Summers didn't blame him. It had hit him again when Hazard had tapped his chest. The scar that Grames had left, that stupid scar. And Summers had been there, had held Hazard's arm.
"Jesus," Summers asked himself, "why were you such a little shit back then?"
Jesus didn't offer any special insight on that question, so Summers settled for staring out the windshield and trying to navigate to their destination. The city of Wahredua had been built in stages. First, there had been the section of town along the river, when river traffic had been steady. Then, just as trade along the Grand River began to die, the MP lines had come through. Wahredua had stretched north to meet the lines. Although rail traffic had been steady, Wahredua had stagnated until two decades earlier. Summers and Hazard had been in high school together when one of Roxall College's most successful alumni, a self-described tuna baron with a reputation for decimating marine populations, endowed the school with several $100 million. Almost overnight, Roxall became the dominant political force in Wahredua, and its power only grew as the school rose in rankings and attracted brighter and better and more students from across the world. Wahredua had changed with Roxall, although Summers thought Hazard didn't seem to see it. The new section of Wahredua, where they were driving now, had grown up to accommodate the growing college. There were pho shops and Indian buffets and kebab stands built alongside pubs and pizza places and Subway sandwich shops. The whole world had come to Wahredua, and they'd brought the world with them. 20 years ago, when Hazard and Summers had been in high school, Wahredua might have been a backwater town, provincial, small-minded, and with all the accompanying evils. Even if Hazard didn't see it, though, Summers knew that Wahredua had changed, and he was glad it had changed for the better. Unlike the brick buildings that populated the stretch of town along the river, or the mixture of fieldstone and aging timber that ran north to meet the MP lines, this portion of Wahredua was a mixture of styles and materials: glass, industrial woods and metals, cement, stucco, stone, a conglomerate of 21st century styles. The streets were wider, and everything was laid out in neat urban blocks, complete with apartment buildings and green spaces and parking garages. Somebody could have plucked up this part of Wahredua and set it down in Chicago, near Wicker Park, maybe, and nobody would have noticed the difference. "What's that?" Hazard asked, sniffing. Summers took a breath. The air held a rich, buttery aroma.
"Kolacha."
"What?"
"Kolacha." At Hazard's uncomprehending look, Summers nodded at the bakery they were passing. "It's a pastry. They put meat in them, or fruit, lots of stuff."
"You want one?"
Hazard ignored the question.
"Did you get breakfast? Where are you staying? Apparently, Hazard decided one of these questions was worth answering because he said, the motor court? It took Summers a moment to realize what he meant. Bridal Veil? Holy hell, that place is like 100 years old. You're lucky it didn't fall down while you were sleeping.
It's fine.
It's got bedbugs, or lice, or God only knows what. You can't stay there.
I already am staying there, so I guess I can.
Listen, I've got an extra bedroom. You can stay there until you find a place.
What are you looking for?
This part of town's got a lot of life. There are clubs, bars, great places to eat.
Summers glanced at Hazard. You seem like you might want some peace and quiet, though.
I'm down on the riverfront, one of the old warehouses. They converted some of them into lofts about 10 years back. I could ask if they've got any units available.
No.
No what? No, you don't want me to ask, or no, you don't need a place to stay?
Just no. This isn't work.
You want to talk? We talk about work.
Summers fought the urge to run a hand through his hair and just maybe growl in frustration.
We're partners. We've got to know each other.
We do. We know each other real goddamn well.
Summers ignored the comment and pressed on. Like, are you dating someone? Are you married? Do you have kids?
Me, I don't care. If it's not work, I don't want to hear it.
This time, Summers did growl, just a little, just for a moment.
All right, he said.
Yeah, work.
You started telling me about this case. There's been vandalism against gays?
Yeah, pretty big gay community, especially considering the size and location of the town. Really close-knit, pretty tight connections to the university.
And the university is the elephant in the room, Hazard said. So the university gets mad, and everybody starts hopping pretty fast to try to make them happy. Cravens hires me because it looks good.
Upchurch had already decided to take the state job, and you were by far the most qualified person to apply.
Summers paused.
Why did you apply here anyway? You could have gone anywhere.
Hazard ignored him.
That's a work question. If we're going to work together, I deserve an answer.
Hazard stopped, obviously changing what he'd been about to say. I didn't really have a choice.
Why not?
Some shit went down in the department. Politics, I guess you could call it. The captain knew Cravens and knew they were going to have an opening. He told me I could either pack it in and go home or...
Or what?
Or I could spend the rest of my life shuffling papers.
What happened?
Like I said, politics.
That wasn't an answer, but Summers knew better than to press it. At least, not at the moment.
So the case? Hazard said.
Yeah, university's been putting the screws to Cravens to find out who's behind the vandalism, etc. It's been quiet for a while, so this is getting a lot of attention.
What kind of vandalism?
Broken windows, slashed tires. Somebody threw a homemade Molotov cocktail at one woman's house. It didn't go off, it just burned. And the guys who showed up managed to keep it quiet. Most people think it was just a bag of burning dog shit or something like that.
A Molotov cocktail? That sounds like a hell of a lot more than vandalism.
Yeah, a couple of women were attacked outside a club a few weeks ago. White guy, late 30s, early 40s, grabbed one of them by the hair and slammed her into a brick wall. Then he told the other girl he was going to show her what all you dykes are missing out on. He tried to rape her, but the girl got away.
You find him?
Neither woman could describe him beyond that, and there's a lot of people that fit that description.
Sounds like one of those lunatics, the militia type. Is still around here?
Summers nodded, signaling as he turned onto a small, quiet side street. The Ozark Volunteers. You remember them?
Hard to forget when they come through town with a sign that says God hates fags, and you're the only gay boy for 100 miles in any direction.
They still do that. Did it a few weeks ago.
A few weeks ago?
Summers nodded. Right when this was all starting. The Ozark Volunteers, or, by their full name, the Supreme Justification of God in the Ozark Citizen Volunteers, had given every decent person in Door County a pain in the ass for the last 40 years. They weren't directly related to the KKK, or the Montana Militia, or a crazy fundamentalist church, but they shared elements with all of them. They lived, for the most part, in the unincorporated parts of Door County, outside of Wahredua's limits, and they spent their free time drinking beer, shooting the bottles, and either cooking meth or using it, as the situation demanded. In the last few months, the Ozark Volunteers had found new leadership, radicalized, militant leadership that had taken the volunteers out of the sticks and into the heart of Wahredua, where they staged public marches and demonstrations against fags, liberals, atheists, whores, and anything or anyone else that put an itch in their garters.
"Did they scare you?" Summers asked, the question leaving his mouth before he could stop it.
"The volunteers, when you were a kid." The car rolled to a stop in front of a row of taupe-colored townhouses. Hazard snorted, and for a moment, Summers thought he would ignore the question. Then Hazard answered, tipping his head towards the townhouse ahead of them.
"Scared the shit out of me." It was the first thing Hazard had said that didn't carry underlying rage. It sounded, to Summers' surprise, almost vulnerable. Then, in a hard voice, Hazard said, "You got me."
"What?"
"I'm in. Let's demolish these redneck assholes."
Summers broke out in the first genuine smile of the day. Chapter 5. October 24th. Monday. 10:02 a.m. It took all of Hazard's willpower not to smile back at Summers when the man started grinning. There was something genuine about it, something honestly bright that made Hazard forget, for a moment, how much he hated the prick. "Fine," Hazard told himself as he got out of the Impala. He'd work with Summers on this case. Like it or not, Hazard was hooked. This case was pushing all the right buttons. Ignorant bullies, LGBT victims, a chance to kick the ass of a boogeyman from his past. Hazard couldn't walk away from that. Hell, you couldn't have dragged him away from it. And if that meant working with Summers, he'd work with Summers, for now. This part of Wahredua was completely new to Hazard. It had obviously been built in response to the college's rapid expansion, but it showed signs of careful planning and execution. This quiet street, for example, already had large trees lining the sidewalk, and the taupe-colored townhomes were well-built and maintained. A large swath of green, complete with a playground, capped the end of the block. The smell of the pastries, kolaches, had faded, and now Hazard tasted the hot tar patches on the street and the mulch dust from the playground. They were summer tastes. He was surprised to find that they made him think of home and, even more surprising, happy days. Whatever happiness those memories held, though, dissipated as he studied the townhouse in front of them. Two stories with a manicured flower bed, a trimmed hedge, and an attached garage. It looked like it could have belonged to any town USA, except for one thing. Across the garage door, spray-painted in foot-high letters, were the words, "Die Fag." Someone had obviously tried to scrub away the letters, resulting in a blurry final E of die, but the effort had also obviously been given up.
"Who lives here?"
Summers checked his notepad. "Rosendo Cruz Cervantes is the owner, according to the patrol that stopped by, but he wasn't the one who called it in."
"Who did?"
"The name here is Nicholas Flores."
"Let's talk to Mr. Flores."
Summers let Hazard take the lead, and so Hazard followed the walk to the front door. He raised a hand to knock, but before he could, the door swung inwards, and someone, a man, hurtled out. Hazard twisted aside,
moving more by reflex than conscious thought, and snagged the man's shirt. The man stumbled, and a cardboard box flew out of his arms and tumbled onto the grass, spilling shirts across the yard.
"What the?"
The man stared at Hazard in shock, and then his expression hardened in anger. He planted both hands on Hazard's chest and shoved free of Hazard's grip.
"Who the hell are you?"
"Police," Summers said. "Detective Summers."
"Detective Hazard."
Hazard paused, taking in the details. The man in front of him was young, 22, maybe 23, and gorgeous. He had copper-colored skin and thick, wavy black hair. Tall and slender, he was built like a dancer, and every movement displayed the perfect lines of his body. It didn't matter that he was wearing a ratty t-shirt with holes and baggy sweats. It just made him look better. Hazard was trying to remember what he'd been going to say.
"We had a call," Summers prompted.
"Right. Vandalism. We're here to talk to..."
Damn, he'd forgotten the name. He flashed Summers a pleading glance. Summers, for his part, kept his expression smooth.
"Nicholas Flores?"
"Nico," the young man crossed his arms across his chest. A very well-defined chest, Hazard noticed, through the thin cotton.
"That's me."
Hazard decided he either had to jump in and start talking, or he was at risk of swallowing his tongue.
"Can you tell us what happened?"
"I woke up this morning, came outside, and found that."
He jerked a thumb at the garage door. "I tried scrubbing it out, and then I realized I was being stupid. I called the police. Now you guys are here. That's about it."
"Mr. Flores, could we come in and talk for a few minutes?"
Nico snorted.
"I'm not going back inside that place unless it's to get the rest of my stuff."
"Some sort of problem?" Summers asked.
"Yeah, I've been living with a miserable, lying, cheating waste of a human being. For 8 months. 8 months! That sound like a problem to you?"
"Are you talking about..." Summers consulted his notepad.
"The homeowner, Mr. Cervantes?"
"Chendo, yeah. That's the soulless, conniving, sneaky..."
"Is Mr. Cervantes home?"
"If he were home, I'd be too busy ripping off his balls to talk to you."
"Mr. Flores," Hazard said, "it's not in your best interest to say things like that, especially not when talking to the police."
"Why not?"
Nico walked past Hazard, but close, close enough that his arm brushed Hazard's chest and stooped, gathering the fallen clothing and putting it back in the cardboard box.
"It's the truth. I'd put that piece of shit's head through a windshield if I had the chance."
"Were you and Mr. Cervantes in a relationship?"
Nico gave a bitter laugh, shoving another shirt into the box.
"Mr. Flores?"
Straightening to his full height, Nico met Hazard's gaze.
"No, I wouldn't say we were in a relationship. You can't have a relationship with a guy who goes around sleeping with everything that has a pulse, can you?"
"But you were involved romantically with him."
"What do you care?"
A crooked smile crossed Nico's features.
"You interested?"
Hazard felt his face heat. Summers intervened, saying, "We're trying to establish the facts, Mr. Flores."
"God, it's roasting out here. Fuck it. I changed my mind. Let's go inside and drink the rest of Chendo's beer."
Without waiting for an answer, he tossed the cardboard box onto the porch and disappeared into the house. Hazard glanced at Summers, who was trying, and failing, to hide a smile.
"Shut up," Hazard said, before following Nico into the house.
The inside of the townhouse matched the outside. Dark stained wood floors, ultra-modern furniture and color scheme, lots of glass and steel and white. Along one wall hung a row of pictures, and many of them featured Nico and another young Latino man embracing. Other pictures were of Nico, alone and in various stages of undress. Before Hazard and Summers could get deeper into the house, Nico returned, carrying three beers by the neck. He took a drink from one and offered the others. Hazard and Summers shook their heads.
"Fine, but you owe me a drink,"
Nico said, his eyes locked on Hazard, his smile still crooked and, in Hazard's view, hot enough to start a grease fire. Then, his face flattening in anger, he said, I guess I'll leave these for Chendo. He swung the bottles at the row of pictures, glass shattered and beer splashed everywhere. Pictures clattered to the floor, followed by more glass breaking. The yeasty smell of beer filled the small entryway. You need to calm down, Mr. Flores, Summers said, unless you'd rather take this conversation to the station. Whatever you want, detective. Nico took another drink and then nodded to a sofa and chairs. You want to sit down and talk? Let's sit. You want to cuff me? Well, he grinned. You can do whatever you want. You too, he added to Hazard. You can definitely do whatever you want to me. Do you know where Mr. Cervantes is? Summers asked. Off with whatever piece of ass he found. How long has he been gone?
A couple of days.
How long exactly? Hazard said. I haven't seen him since Friday night. We had a fight. He went out to blow off some steam. I thought he'd come back and we'd work it out. Instead, Nico cut off with a laugh and took a drink of beer.
What happened?
He's been texting me, checking in. Really sweet of him, don't you think? He fished a phone out of his sweats and tossed it to Hazard. On the screen, a text conversation was open with Chendo Cervantes. The list of recent messages had come from Chendo over the course of 2 days, beginning late Friday night and coming regularly through Monday morning. The most recent was from only a few hours before, and it read, It's nice to wake up next to a man who knows how to take care of my needs. Wish I could have said the same for you. The other messages were similar. Taunts, boasts about sexual exploits, and humiliating descriptions of Nico's inadequacies. By the time Hazard had finished the recent texts, Nico had finished his beer. With the same hard, angry look on his face, he flung it at the wall of pictures. Another handful of framed photos crashed to the floor.
Oops. Sorry.
Hazard passed the phone to Summers, who glanced at it and passed it back to Nico. Mr. Flores, you understand I have to ask you this. Did you write those words on the garage, maybe because of your dispute with Mr. Cervantes?
No.
Why would I do it and then report myself?
Do you know who did? Hazard asked.
No.
No ideas? Nobody that Mr. Cervantes might have had an altercation with? Nobody with a grudge?
What about the 100,000 rednecks that live around here? All those guys who say God hates fags. You know who I'm talking about. Jesus, this has been going on for months. It was only a matter of time.
You think it was only a matter of time before someone targeted Mr. Cervantes?
Chendo has a big mouth, big ego, too. He thinks of himself as an activist.
Why did you call it in? Summers said. If you hate him so much, why not leave it and just walk away?
Because nobody should be able to do that and get away with it. I don't care if it's me or Chendo or anybody else. It's wrong.
Are you an activist? Hazard said.
Nico's crooked smile flashed out again.
I'm a student, detective. Do you want to take me to school?
I think that's all we need to know from you, Mr. Flores.
Nico's smirk stayed right where it was. We'll take some pictures, Summers said. Dust for prints, take a look around.
Yeah, sure,
Nico said, but his eyes didn't leave Hazard's face.
I'm done with this place. You do whatever you want.
Do you have a phone number? Hazard asked. An address where we can contact you?
Nico didn't say anything, but the mocking twinkle in his eyes made Hazard's face heat again. He scribbled something on the back of an envelope lying on the coffee table and tossed it in Hazard's lap. Hazard glanced at it. His fist crumbled the paper, but not before Summers saw. It had a phone number and then the words, Don't forget, you owe me a drink. Here's my card, Summers said, and Hazard thought he heard suppressed amusement. If you think of anything else. Hazard led the way out of the house,
Nico followed them as far as the door and called after them. Chendo's going to show up in a day or so. He'll probably call you and pitch a fit about this. Tell him I said he deserves it.
Thanks for your help today, Mr. Flores, Summers said.
Nico didn't answer, but he watched them as they moved to the garage and Summers began to take pictures with his phone.
He's giving you the eye, man,
Summers said in a low voice as he snapped pictures.
Shut up.
Once we wrap up this case, you better give that boy a call. Summers was grinning now.
Are you kidding me? He's a baby.
He's hot. Don't give me that look. I'm straight, but even I'd hit that.
Please stop talking, Hazard growled, before I punch him in the throat.
Hazard couldn't hear it, but he knew Summers was laughing. Chapter 6, October 24th, Monday, 5:07 p.m. The rest of the day had passed in a blur of work, taping off the garage door, examining the property for any physical evidence, interviewing Cervantes's neighbors, and then back to the station for paperwork and phone calls. They found nothing. Nobody knew anything. Everything ended hard and fast. Hazard tried Cervantes's cell phone several times, but he wasn't able to make contact. Instead, he left two messages, a lengthy explanation and a shorter follow-up. By the time Hazard decided to look at the related vandalism and assault cases, he realized that Summers was pushing in his chair.
Come on, Summers said.
I'm going to stay, get in a few hours of catch-up.
No, Summers said, smiling to soften the blow. You're not. You're coming with me.
Oh, yeah?
Yes. We're going to get roaring drunk with the rest of Wahredua's detectives.
I'm not...
Summers moved over to Hazard's desk and perched on the edge. He was close enough that Hazard could smell a mixture of sweat and fabric softener. This isn't optional, okay? This is a small town. It's a small department, and inside that small department, we're an even smaller unit. Just five of us. Four once Upchurch leaves. We're a team.
I'm part of the team. I already told you I was in. That doesn't mean I'm getting drinks with you.
You don't get it. This isn't St. Louis. You can't separate work and life. This is Wahredua. This is small-town stuff. Everybody is in everybody's business. That's just the way it goes. Besides, I stuck my neck out to get you on. I'm not letting you make me look bad.
This is ridiculous.
It's the way things are. You want these guys to have your back? You have to do things the right way. You ever want to get out of here? With a good recommendation from Cravens, I mean. You put in the time with the other detectives. Now, put on your jacket and let's go.
This is just so goddamn ridiculous, Hazard muttered. But he grabbed his jacket and stood.
What's ridiculous, Summers said low and dry, is how you pick up ass with that whole dark and brooding thing you're doing. Before Hazard could reply, Summers was already whistling and hurrying towards the doors. Hazard caught up with him outside the station, but when Hazard turned into the parking lot, Summers whistled at him and jerked his head.
This way, big boy. We're walking.
It's hot, Hazard said. Hot was an understatement. The muggy air was pasted to his skin, and it felt like he was swimming instead of walking.
He'll survive.
They walked south a few blocks, and the river came into view. The Grand River ran fast and wide. Sunlight lay in flat panels along the water, orange and yellow and white, bobbing with the current. The river smell came on the air, a mixture of mud and wet wood. Between the men and the water, Market Street followed the curve of the river, and cars streamed in both directions. The rumble of engines swallowed any noise the water might have made.
Swinney's tough, Summers said, breaking the silence between them. She's not the smartest, but she works like a mule. First female detective since Cravens. Not an easy job, especially not here.
Summers looked at Hazard as though waiting for a reply, but Hazard only grunted.
He wasn't going to get dragged into gossip this early.
Lender, he's her partner. He's squirrely, lots of energy, bouncing off the walls, but you can't tell at first. At first, all you see are those big glasses. One time, he was sitting there at the desk, and I'd just started as detective, and I thought he was this boring little mouse. Couldn't even really see him, if you know what I mean, because I had my head so puffed up and because he seemed so quiet and small. So he was sitting there, and I was sitting there, and he said he needed to show me something in the evidence locker. He said it was coke, and as I was getting it down from the shelf, it spilled on me. Someone, Lender, obviously, had cut a hole in the plastic. I didn't realize that, of course. I just about jumped out of my skin. That's how bad I wanted to get out of there. Then somehow Lender had me convinced that I had to strip down and sprint to the locker room to shower. And he'd bag my clothes for evidence, and I was panicking because I thought I'd fucked up royally. So I did. In spite of himself, Hazard was smiling. And? And the whole goddamn shift was lined up in the hall, saluting me as I ran. And I was still so scared that I kept running, even though part of me knew the whole thing was a setup. And Anthony Lee, he's the biggest, blackest guy on the force, shouted he'd never seen a coked-up white boy run so fast. By the time I got to the showers, I figured I was a dead man, if not for the coke, then because I'd just streaked through a government building. Then I looked down and realized it wasn't coke. It was flour. Hell yes, it was flour.
What'd you do?
I knew I had to do something, so I turned around and marched out of the locker room, and Lender was there grinning like a monkey. And he said something like, "Gee, Summers, looks like God shorted you a few inches on the business end."
"Oh my God," Hazard groaned. "Straight guys are literally all the same."
Summers started to laugh.
"So?" Hazard said. "What happened?"
So I turned to Anthony Lee and I said, "Could you lend me your coat? I think there's a draft." And everybody busted up laughing.
"I would have killed him."
"Nah, Lender's all right. That's just him, though. Quiet on the outside, but all hell broke loose on the inside. Ask him about the time I hooked up with a lady friend." Hazard fought to keep from rolling his eyes. Straight guys really were all the same.
"And Upchurch?"
He'd asked the question before realizing it, and he was surprised at how easily Summers had drawn him into the conversation. "Upchurch," Summers said, drawing the name out and then hesitating and lapsing into silence.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.